So today let's try to finish this mooring systems. So analysis of spread mooring systems. So this is, let us try to study this. Now a spread mooring system is typically employed in offshore platforms. Say this is your semi-submersible, it's coming. So in the simplest case, let us say that this platform is anchored by four anchors. So this is a spread mooring system. Unlike the mooring systems that you will see normally in ships, that is, you have one anchor. Ships in rivers that you have seen, they are normally anchored with one anchor. So that is called a bow anchor. So I will come back to the mooring system of ships later on, because I am doing this in detail. So this is your ship. Now later in the class we will see how the anchoring is, mooring is done. So normally you have your anchors coming either from this hose pipe or from here, and ship is anchored like this. Now if you want to control the motion of the ship, normally they drop an anchor, but it's not necessary. Normally they do it by means of one anchor only, but in this case you will find, since you are restricting the motion of the semi-submersible, so this is your semi-submersible. So what are the motions that are going to be restricted? So it is allowed to have surge, sway, and so these are the motions that are going to take place. Heave also, we are not at present studying heave motion. So the motions that we will be studying is this surge, then you have sway motions. Sway is the athwart ship motion, that is in this direction. Surge is in this, the other one is what? The rotation about this axis, what it is called? Surge is in this direction, sway is in this direction, the yaw, this motion, this is called yaw motion. So these are the three motions let us try to restrict for semi-submersible by means of anchoring. So these are the motion restrictions. Motion restrictions. Now what you do is you find out the, now all these motions are taking place in the what? So this is your, say this is the CG of the semi-submersible, you take it out here. So this is your y direction, this is in the x direction. So this is x and y, followed. So TH is out here, so this is a case of symmetric mooring. Now actually what I have drawn is only four anchor lines, but in actual practice you will find for FPSOs and etcetera, if you do not have a turret, I think one diagram I have already shown you last class, you have got to have a mooring like this. And also there may be mooring wires. So this is also a spread mooring system. Spread mooring system, FPSO. FPSO without turret. So different offshore this thing platforms will have their different mooring systems. So this is an example of an FPSO without turret mooring. Turret mooring actually, that means here the motions are again that are going to be restricted as your surge, sway and yaw motions. Now if you want to restrict, the maximum restriction that you can impose normally is in the TLP. TLP has lot of heave restrictions. So that is because of the tension in the tethers. Now this tension in the tethers, how you calculate tension? That is buoyancy minus weight is the tension in the tethers. So this you have to adjust the tension in the tethers in order to restrict TLP heave. So TLP actually the design is of this platform is made in such a way along with the tethers such that there are practically there is no heave motion. But heave in semi-submersibles or in FPSOs will be there. You cannot actually strike down heave motion. Now if you want to do this, so all semi-submersibles and FPSOs, so FPSOs and semi-submersibles, they should have a what is called a heave compensating mechanism. Heave compensating device. So that consists of winches and tensioning mechanism. You have winches. Now this is also quite complicated. Some diagrams I will try to show you. Winches and a tensioning device. Now this tensioning you can effect by means of huge springs. Tensioning by springs. So this mechanism also is called a heave compensating device. So normally these you will find in FPSOs and semi-submersibles. And these are situated on the say intermediate deck, on the twin deck of the platform. Somewhere out here you will find. So this is your marine riser is coming. So if you are in the offshore field, so you have to think about the mooring systems and what else you have to think about. Now mooring systems and efficient mooring system will obviously restrict motions of the ships, but then also design of these are two things which you have to concentrate on, design of mooring systems. Now you have to figure out how many mooring lines you are going to give. So whether here I have given 1, 2, say this is the minimum 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, but again you can have number you can have out here also. So all these are anchor points. So I will show you the diagrams or pictures of these type of anchors. They are huge anchors, they are called gravity anchors. So you have to find out T horizontal for all these cases and find out the components in this x direction and find out component in the y direction. Okay. So design of mooring systems, what is you have to, sorry. Number two is design of what? Very crucial, I am telling you. The two most important things which you should know, design of mooring systems, design of marine risers. Now these are very crucial for floating platforms. Now this marine riser I have already talked about, that here actually you can have flexible risers. This is a separate area of study altogether. So this we can discuss when we discuss about offshore pipelines and risers. Offshore pipelines of course they don't have flexible joints, but marine risers you have flexible joints, and nowadays they are doing away with the steel risers at. They are called, sometimes you have SCRs. SCR is called a steel catenary riser. So this is actually a separate area of study, steel catenary riser. So these are two things. Anyway, we will come back to this riser if we have time. So these are two focal points of your floating platforms. So here actually you do not bother too much about the resistance and propulsion part of the ship, because you are not transporting cargo from one location to another, but these are the area of concerns. Now what you do, say let us take the simplest case. Now here you have this T horizontal will come here. Say this, your angle is making an angle of psi with the horizontal. Now you take a component of in this direction and also a component in the y direction. So actually in the static analysis, what you are doing for static equilibrium, what are the forces? So you have to calculate sigma fx equal to 0, then sigma fy equal to 0, and you find out this sigma moment of xy will be equal to 0. So this you find out from the environmental forces. So this is your origin. Now you just take, say let us take one force, say TH. Now here you find out mean external loads on vessel. Or rather you write mean external load caused by waves. Waves, wind and current. So wave force, how are you going to go into calculate? Wave force. So you have to calculate all these three forces, mind you. Now waves actually, I have already talked about how to calculate the wave force. So wave force calculation is done by what? Fine. Wave pressure. This has to be integrated. From what? From Bernoulli equation. So here actually you have to find out what type of waves you are getting out here at this region. Ultimately you have to calculate the pressure, wave pressure, which coming from wave velocity and acceleration, velocity potential. So this has to be calculated. Now current, the other one is wind. Wind actually I have told you they are of two types. One is called steady wind. Steady wind, and the other is called gust. So these actually there are explicit formulas with the wind velocity. Wind velocity square, projected surface to wind, shape and shield factor. Gust, how are you going to calculate? Now remember in the ocean engineering environment, all these load calculations are very important. So these are actually the load calculations. Now wind actually velocity you will find, So this is your mean sea level, MSL. Now wind velocity has a profile, which is uniform about above 10 meters from the mean sea level, and then it goes like this. So this I have already talked about. So now you find out the velocity from here. So this is your wind velocity profile. Current also has the more or less the same profile, or it may be different actually according to the intensity of the current. So these actually either you have to do or you find from oceanography. Oceanographic calculations you have to make. So after doing all this, you calculate this TH. Now F1M, here what is done, find out the mean. Say F1M is mean horizontal force. Now I told you in this book actually what they have said, you proceed with the mean, but normally in the design scenario you don't do calculation with one load, isn't it? That is very dangerous. Here what you normally do is, I told you, you take the 100-year storm criteria, 100-year storm criteria, then you take some mean or median value, say go to 50-year storm or 25-year period, like this you calculate. So you always, you have to, whenever you are doing calculations, you perform what is called a design matrix. Never give one value to your client. In offshore or any design, they don't go like that, isn't it? Because he's not going to get convinced. Offshore is very tricky business. First of all, it is very costly, and the other thing is safety requirements are very stringent. So perform design matrix with various loads. Now remember, your loads are also not one-off loads. So you have to calculate loads from all these waves, wind and current, and then you have to combine all this and find. Here of course the calculation has been done with only one value. So here is the mean horizontal force from this wind, waves and current. But when you go to any of these offshore engineering firms, they have sophisticated programs. Here of course this is only one line solution, wind, waves, current. So that is normally not the case. So you have complex programs to take care of that. So and at the end you produce a design matrix from a what is called, you have to formulate your design spiral. And ship design, I think you are studying ship design. So any design, you find that this this is spiral. They formulate this. So here actually, and moorings are just one spoke. Moorings actually you will find one spoke of the design spiral. But mooring itself is a very complex calculation, which most of you are doing in Orcaflex. So anyway, so here actually this is the mean horizontal force in x, say let us call this in x direction. So when you study your design, your marine design or ship design, the professor or teacher will talk about this design spiral concept. Now F2M, you find out the same thing. So in this is in y direction. And last one is what you have. What is this fxy? Or you can call this as f6. So this is your, this is the y direction forces. Now what is f6? That is the moment. Moment in xy plane. Now F1M, if you want to do this, you find in the x direction I have said. So if this is TH you write horizontal anchor line tension. So what is F1M? So this is TH cos psi. Okay. Now here you have to do it for, say if there are number of anchor lines, you have to do for all the anchor lines. So you take I equals to 1 to n. So you write anchor lines, number of anchor lines. The semi-submersible may have other anchor lines. So one anchor line might come here, out here, another anchor line we have here. So you find out all the force components in the x direction. So this you write number of anchor lines. So this is denoted by n. So same thing you do for the y component. So y component will be how much? So you do it for anchor line I equals to 1 to n. Now this will be TH cos phi or sin phi? So the last one is the moment term. So you find out what is the moment. So moment, what is the moment? So this is, say TH cos phi. So what is the, what moment you are getting? So this is giving a clockwise moment about O, TH cos phi multiplied by this arm. So that is how much? So your x coordinate is, let me write. So this point x and y, let us say this, you define this as say x I y I point. So x is this horizontal direction. So TH cos phi minus y. And the other one is going to be how much? So the other one is going to be, so this direction it is TH cos psi. In this direction this is TH sin phi. So which one, you take one positive and the other negative. So this one will be, if you take anticlockwise as positive, so anticlockwise moment is becoming TH sine phi multiplied by YI. And the other one, if you take as negative, so this is your clockwise moment coming from TH cos phi. So this is TH cos phi, and how much is the lever arm? Sorry, this is psi, not phi. I'm making a mistake. So this is YI, isn't it? So the other term is TH sin phi, so this has to be multiplied by XI, sorry this. Anyway, let me write this again. So the F6M, this is equals to sigma I equals to 1A. So from here, which one we are taking as positive? Anticlockwise is positive. So that is TH sin phi multiplied by XI. So this is TH sin psi multiplied by XI. The other one is negative, so this is becoming as TH cos psi. Now what is the lever arm? Lever arm is only YI. So here, then we can take this TH thing out. So F6M, the yaw moment, we are getting this as I equals to 1 to n multiplied by TH multiplied by, this is XI sin psi, and this is minus YI cos psi. So like this you have to calculate. Now this, so here you can see these three formulas that I have written. So this F1, F2 and F6, this you get from the environmental forces. So that has to balance your this TH cos phi, TH sin phi, this moment. So from these equations you find out TH. So this is your one, this is second equation, and this is the third equation. So this you write, this F1, F1M, F2M and F6M, these are known forces and moment. Known forces and moments calculated from environmental forces. Now, what are the other known values? XI, YI, this find out, these are also known, known from position of anchoring, or right position of anchor point. So, these are also known values. The only unknown is now the psi. Psi is also known. Or you can find out, because you will be suspending all these cables. So you can measure with respect to your psi. Obviously, you will be some average value, because at any point of time, your semi-submersible will always be acted upon by environmental forces. So if you go on board this semi-submersible, you will find that this platform is having this kind of motion. So psi will also be your average value. So this, anyway, with the average only you are calculating, so psi is also known. So TH you can find out. So once you know TH, then obviously you can calculate anchor line tension. So anchor line tension is that T phi cos phi w is going to be your this anchor line tension TH. So this is the gist of the problem, what you have to calculate from the environmental forces. Now what happens if F increases? Now suppose suddenly you will find a storm has come. So then what are you going to do? Now in the next, there is a problem out here which we will solve later on. You will find the semi-submersible is acted on by a storm. The captain of the ship is not aware of this, so he finds the whole semi-submersible to be going forward. The surge is taking place. So now how you are going to limit? So that means his aim is to bring the platform to the original position of this, isn't it? Suppose the cable lines, there is no stiffness, zero stiffness. Now if there is zero stiffness in any structure, then what is the result of that? Say compliant structure, this anchored vessel is also a compliant structure. There is no, is not having any stiffness. That means with the environmental forces, this will go like this. So there is a swept, so it will be swept away. Now to prevent this sweeping away, so what you must do? So there is a surge motion is going and this whole semi-submersible is going in this direction. So what the captain of the ship has to do? So these are some of the problems. So the thing is, the ship is moored, the storm has come. Now immediately you cannot lift off the anchors, it will take time, isn't it? Now at any cost, so there are two options that he can do is, you stop the production of oil, abandon. So that means, that is called in the offshore, they have a special term for this, they call it weather downtime. Weather downtime. The platform is down and out of operation, out of operation. So this is also not a very desirable feature, because of the fact is, during this period you will not be able to lift oil from the oil well. So that means the platform is no more producing oil, it is having a weather downtime. So weather downtime is a very crucial aspect. You come across this when you study this. Now but suppose the captain of the ship wants to prevent weather downtime. So he is under pressure, no? You have to deliver so much of oil to your tanker, because that is the economic output that you are getting from the platform. You are selling so much of oil. So in any business, normally the quicker you take out the oil, so much is the profit. I mean, you are able to sell off. Now, so what he has to do? He has to bring the platform onto the original position. So that he can only do by changing tension. So you ride the vessel on anchor. So that is called riding anchor. Riding anchor on anchor chains. So this we will try to calculate. Suppose how much anchor ride you have to do in order to bring the ship again back to the original position. So this is my actual the equilibrium or static position where I can take out the maximum quantity of oil. Now this is only the surge motion. So there will also be sway, there will be yaw motions, etc. So but those have to be controlled. So normally, so you try to, ship is try to, so that is, this is normally done, riding anchor on anchor chains by increasing and decreasing TH. So normally you will find nowadays most of these ships, they are equipped with what is called a DP system, directional positioning system. So this is actually a feedback and control mechanism inside the ship, and the captain of the ship, that is, he looks into the terminal and he can see the what is the ride of the vessel and how much tension he has to increase on all the winches. So remember, all these are winched. So here you have an anchor winch, at this end also we have an anchor winch. So normally you increase the tension or decrease. So either you have to pay out anchor line here, and you have to retrieve anchor line here in order to bring the ship back to your original position. Suppose you are having this sway motion, then you have to do it for alternate either this one or this cable. So you have to have a control on the winch, mooring winch. So all mooring winches are now centralized along with, so this is mooring winches, plus you may have thruster control. So all these are now centralized into a DP system, that is called a directional positioning system of the ship. Essentially a feedback and control mechanism, which is a feedback and control. Feedback and control from environmental loads. So nowadays the master of the ship, he doesn't have to do all the hand calculations. So all these are programmed inside the computer, and only he has to increase or decrease the winch, and on a nice computer screen he can see the position of the vessel, and he has a broadband. So this is a DP system. Now this, normally the equations I have given you, so those are the equations that are fed to make this feedback and control. Now coming to a problem, so let us take a problem, since some of you are interested in this. So here is a semi-submersible or a platform. Now semi-submersibles, they hardly have a single anchor line. You will find semi-submersibles normally having 4, 6, 8 anchor lines. So this is a case of a semi-submersible. Let us take an idealistic view. There are 2 anchor lines. Say one forward and one aft. Now anchor lines usually have a portion of the cable lying flat on the seabed. You will never find anchor lines which are completely taut. So these are steel catenary anchor lines. Say another anchor line is coming out here. So that is also lying flat on the seabed. So this is the point of anchor line, say this is at A, and this is point B, anchor B. Now, the length of the vessel is, let us suppose this is L. Follow. Now, here what is the total length? Total length of anchor line that you have paid out is from point of anchor to point of suspension of the cable. So, that is LS. So, I am not good at drawing anyway. So, this is the LS value. This is L, do not write LS. So, this one is, this diagram I have already drawn in your earlier class. Now, this is your LS. Now, you tell me how you are going to heave anchor. Now, when you have to heave anchor, you, so this is, this distance is L minus LS. Now, you make it 0. So, when you make it 0, you just pull in the anchor line out here. So, this is your anchoring point and your chain cable is going to go like this. So, this is your TH. And this is the vertical direction. So, heaving, you can never lift anchor in this situation. So, you have to bring in the anchor line and then make L equal to L and then it will go off. Now, say this is a, this is the situation. Now, we have calculated this value of so, this was small x or capital X. So, this you have calculated this as small x. And capital X is from this end. Now, this is the situation. Your depth of the water depth is given as 200 meters. Now, you write down the problem. Say a platform, we just follow this figure, you know. Say a platform is restrained. From moving by two anchors. With anchor lines of chain. In bracket, I am writing C figure. Okay. Now, the length L of anchor line L is out here, this L means total length, the length L of anchor line. You write this is given in the figure is 600 meters and horizontal pretension. horizontal pretension, you write TH. So this is equal to 300 kilonewtons for. Now, weight of chain in water. Weight of chain in water means the absolute weight corrected for buoyancy. So, that is called weight of chain in water. Now, this is given as weight of chain in water. So, this is what small w, isn't it? Small w is given as 1000 Newton per meter. Now, you assume static environmental forces. On platform. Now you have to find these three. A, you find distance between anchors A and B. Number 2, that is B, you write what is the tension at the platform. Now, number 3 is a little bit difficult. The C is find out how large the environmental force on the platform. To move, say, anchor A. No, anchor A has to be moved. So, what is the environmental force? So, these are the three items you have to calculate. So, without environmental force, you calculate distance between A and B. So, what is the distance between A and B? So, this is the condition of what? Symmetric anchor line, isn't it? So, you have made the problem simple. So, this is a symmetric anchor line. So, this also will be, if this you have taken capital X, so same thing will come out here. So, this is 2x. So, AB distance is how much? See, if you want to calculate AB, you find out, so this distance is L. So, this is 2x plus L. Now, you just employ your formulas to find x. So, calculation we start AB is equals to twice x plus L, but what is the capital X? Now, capital X, if you remember, so we have already worked out as total length of chain minus LS. LS is the suspended length. S actually the subsidy stands for suspended length. So, LS is the suspended length. So, L minus LS plus what? Plus this small x. Now, this capital L, you know, or it has been given. So, L is, now the problem that we are coming is about this small x. So, capital L is equals to 600. That has already been given in the problem. Now, what is this LS we have to find out? LS formula you have got, suspended length of chain cable. So, we have derived the expression last class. You just look into your notes. Now, one thing you do not know is the value of A. So, if you want to calculate this, so 600 so this is minus h 1 plus 2 a h. So what is the formula for L? This is so I have given you that, no? But how I have not worked out? So small x is having the hyperbolic term. And small s is. So this is h into. 1 plus 2 a over h. So, this is to the power half and small x is coming to a hyperbolic term, it will come out. So, we find out the values. So, this is a cos hyperbolic inverse. Now, this is the troublesome part. You have got your calculator? 1 plus, so find these two values. Now, what is this A? A is TH by W. Now, this you can immediately calculate because TH is known. TH you just substitute as 300 kilonewtons and small w is given as 1000 newton per meter. TH is 300 kilonewtons. So, A is given, so this is coming as, now 300 kilonewtons means 300 into 1000 divided by 10 k. So, this is A you are getting as 300. H is known, so you find out this small x and you can find out LS also. Straight away. Yes, found out. Sir, you find out LS and small x. Sir, using this formula, the value of A is known as small h is known.
Sir,
but I do not have the calculator here to find out the value of cos hyperbolic inverse.
Sir,
total
capital X equal to 529.6. 529 you are getting?
529.6.
So this capital X will come out in my expression, you work this out. So this is 100, this is 2 plus 3, I am getting, you check whether you are getting this value or not, 1.667. But how you have found out cos hyperbolic inverse? Is there in his calculator. So this expression, the expression is okay, this one. So this is coming as 529.6. So here, this is your answer, 529.6. So that means AB is coming as, AB is 2 multiplied by 529.6 plus what? The value of A has not been given, the length of the ship. So this, to see how much this is. Now you remember this capital X value, because later on we will find that we have to increase TH. Yeah. So AB is coming up, 529.6 multiplied by 2 is how much? So it is close to 1060, isn't it? So this is 1060, let me write, plus L. Right or wrong? You take as 530.
So 1659.16.
1060, no? 1059 point something. So plus L, so this is your separation. Say this is anchor separation. Now you, the second part you find out, line tension. Break.
The time had finished in the lecture.
Time? He has shown two.